Should we start?
Yes, please.
Yes. Right. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue, which is Pursue 5Z, Pathology of Blood Vessels and Heart. And we are streaming live from Kolkata. We have a very interesting topic, vascular tumors. And to talk on that, we have Dr. Colonel Tanushree Mukherjee. She is an MBBS from GMC Bhopal, MD Path from AFMC Pune, DNB in Pathology. She also trained in Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. She's a Diplomat Fellowship of Royal College of London. Presently, she's a Professor and Senior Advisor in Pathology and Oncopathology at the Command Hospital, Eastern Command. She's an Armed Force Service Person from the last 25 years of professional service. Recognized postgraduate teacher for West Bengal University of Health, a DNB teacher, an affiliate member of RCPath, a life member of IAC-IEPM, with more than 30 international and national publications, best reviewer in MJAFI 2019. She was also previously the HOD and Command Hospital of Chandi Mandir, that is Western Command. With this, before I ask her to start, let me request all of you to keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request, ma'am, please share your screen and let us start. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Screen is visible.
Yes, ma'am, we can see your screen. Just make it full screen, please. Yeah, perfect. Please start.
Thank you so much. Good evening, everyone. Today's topic is vascular tumors. And basically, it is important to the postgraduates from slide point of view because all the cases can come and you have to distinguish from benign versus malignant. And also the recent advances, because now the genetics is also very important and the molecular pathology is involved in the vascular tumors. So I will follow the WHO classification of the tumors, the vascular tumors, the benign tumors, hemangiomas, the various types. So you have to differentiate it from the AV malformations also, arteriovenous malformations. Then there are the intermediate or locally aggressive tumors like the Kaposi-form hemangioendothelioma. Then the intermediate or rarely metastasizing tumors like the retiform hemangioendothelioma, papillary intralymphatic endothelioma, composite hemangioendothelioma, Kaposi sarcoma. Then there is the entity called a pseudomyogenic hemangioendothelioma. And the malignant tumors, there are two basically, epithelioid hemangioendothelioma and angiosarcoma is the other end of the spectrum, this malignant tumor. And then some tumors which are like perivascular tumors, they are not entirely vascular tumors, just to mention them like gliomas, the myopericytoma and the angiolioma. So this is basically the classification which you should remember. The benign vascular tumors, these are the congenital hemangiomas, capillary hemangioma, cavernous hemangioma, varicose hemangioma, microvenular, and the variants. So I'll just touch upon them from the slide point of view. And there can be the tumor-like conditions like the papillary endothelial hyperplasia. This is definitely an MD slide because Meson's tumor people are very fond of. Then there can be a glomeruloid hemangioma or a bacillary angiomatosis. These are tumor-like conditions. Then the intermediate vascular tumors, as I have said, the locally aggressive ones like Kaposi-like hemangioendothelioma. And one more entity but very uncommon is a giant cell angioplastoma. The rarely metastasizing one, I have told, Kaposi's, retiform, papillary intravascular angioendothelioma and composite. And the malignant ones, these are two. And angiosarcomas, they can be again various types, and based upon the etiology also, they are divided into various subtypes. So first, the hemangiomas, most common tumors of the head and neck in infancy and childhood. 7% of all benign soft tissue tumors. It's a true vascular tumor, overgrowth of normal vascular tissue. It grows by endothelial proliferation. Mast cells can be seen within the endothelial walls. They are initially noticed as an erythematous macular patch which progresses through a rapid proliferative phase. Hemangiomas are found in the superficial tissue, deep tissue or both, and may affect any organ. Congenital hemangiomas fully formed at birth, they are non-progressive. These are two terms like rapidly involuting congenital hemangioma rich and non-involuting congenital hemangioma, NICH-NIC. They are that one negative. I will describe, this is a biomarker. The sides, extremities or post-auricular skin. This is a microphotograph of rich, rapidly involuting congenital hemangioma. Then this is a superficial hemangioma, how it presents clinically. Lesions are firm to palpation and do not pulsate or exhibit any thrill or bruise. These are the vascular spaces which show the dilatation, but there is no ATPA. Then capillary hemangioma, which can be of, and again many types. The juvenile capillary hemangioma is the most common type. Complete involution by age of 6 to 7 years. Microscopically, lobules of capillary sized vessels supplied by feeder vessels and vascular space formations vary. The variants could be lobular capillary hemangioma, like pyogenic granuloma, it's a proliferative lesion related to trauma. This is also a slight pyogenic granuloma, superficial dermis like lip, gum, hands, fingers, face of pregnant women when it's called epulis, microscopic examination, organized pattern seen, lateral edges show lobular arrangement, group of capillaries, they proliferate. High power view shows small capillary epithelium line spaces, also surrounded by perithelial or pericytic layer of cells. This is a pyogenic granuloma or a tufted angioma. Acquired in childhood, congenital forms also exist. Then cherry angioma, when you see numerous capillaries with narrow lumina and intercapillary stromal edema and collagenization. This is a cavernous hemangioma. It's a locally destructive due to pressure symptoms and this has no tendency to regress. They are associated with the syndromes like blue rubber blood liver syndrome. In skin and GIT, it presents as cavernous hemangioma and Maffucci syndrome when there are cavernous hemangiomas and enchondromas. Here you can see the microphotograph in which there are numerous large vascular spaces. And this is a verrucous hemangioma, wart-like dark blue papules or nodules. Usually in the distal lower limbs, there is mixture of cavernous and capillary vessels immediately below the hyperkeratotic and acantholytic epidermis. Then microvenular hemangiomas, thin branching capillaries, small venules widely distributed throughout the dermis, an acquired elastotic hemangioma develops in sun-exposed skin of forearms and neck in middle-aged to elderly patients. A superficial proliferation of capillaries in background of solar elastosis, capillaries surrounded by a layer of pericytes. Hobnail hemangioma, usually over trunk or extremities, male predominance, It can be a solitary brown to violaceous papule surrounded by a thin pale area. Microscopically, it is lined by endothelial cells with scanty cytoplasm and rounded nuclei that protrude into the lumina, resembling hobnails. Then there could be arteriovenous hemangioma. The walls of vessels consist of fibrous tissue and most of the blood vessels are veins. Then spindle cell hemangioma. This can again be a slight presence in young adults, skin and subcutaneous involvement in distal extremities, thin walled cavernous vessels lined by bland flattened endothelium admixed with solid areas composed of plump endothelial cells. So you can be confused with the malignancy in this, but it is a spindle cell hemangioma. Then skeletal muscle hemangioma in lower extremity and thigh, poorly circumscribed diffusely infiltrating mass in the muscle composed of thick walled veins to cavernous vascular spaces. Mitotic activity and intraluminal capillary tufting is seen. Then this entity is epithelioid hemangioma. It's a benign vascular neoplasm, well-pumped blood vessels lined by plump epithelioid histiocytoid endothelial cells with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm and a variable eosinophilic infiltrate. And they show recurring gene fusions in the FOS and FOSV genes. This is the microphotograph of epithelioid hemangioma. Then have various histological patterns, and here you see the immunohistochemistry. There's a strong nuclear staining for FOSV in this example of epithelioid hemangioma. And in the lower microphotograph, what you see here is the prominent cytoplasmic vacuolation, which is so characteristic of a epithelioid hemangioma. Synovial hemangioma, benign proliferation of blood vessels in synovium lined surface, commonest in the knee. It may occur in children and adolescents, but is a rare entity. And this is an intramuscular angioma, which can occur within skeletal muscles with mature adipose tissue. Deep hemangiomas, they involve muscle or visceral organs and are more difficult to diagnose. Intraosseous hemangiomas are extremely rare. And this is an example of a glomeruloid hemangioma. It's a distinctive reactive vascular proliferation that occurs in patients with multicentric Castleman disease and Poyam syndrome. Patient has numerous cutaneous angiomas and they can show features of cherry angioma or a glomeruloid hemangioma. So this histologically consists of multiple dilated vascular spaces in the superficial dermis and in the lumina clusters of capillaries with striking resemblance to renal glomeruli. That's why called as a glomeruloid hemangioma. Around the capillaries are pericytes and larger cells with clear cytoplasm and pars positive hyaline globules. These large cells are positive for the endothelial markers CD31, CD34, ERG and FLAVR. So the markers for the hemangiomas, GLUT1, CD31, CD34, and CD133, it is expressed in the primitive cells, and the myeloid markers can also come positive. Then, as I have told, the tumor-like conditions. Now we have finished the hemangioma thing. Then tumor-like conditions, the intravascular papillary endothelial hyperplasia. This represents an exuberant organization and recanalization of thrombus. Exclusive intravascular nature with characteristic fibrinous or hyaline appearance of the papillary stone. So this is a reactive vascular proliferation called as meson tumor, intravascular papillary endothelial hyperplasia. It can present in three different settings, like as a pure form involving an isolated dilated blood vessel, or as a focal change in a variety of pre-existing vascular lesions, including angioma, hemorrhoidal vents, and varices, and although rare, in an extravascular location in association with a hematoma. Histologically, you see here well-circumscribed hemorrhagic lesions, which on close examination reveal a pre-existing dilated vascular space, most commonly a thin walled vein. And there are multiple small papillary structures. That's why it is called as intravascular papillary endothelial hyperplasia or a Meson tumor. The papillary core is composed of hypocellular hyaline collagen with occasional small capillaries. This is again a photomicrograph of a papillary intralymphatic angioendothelium. Then the vascular malformation, just to enumerate them, they are present at birth and they grow commensurately with the patient. They can be capillary, venous, arterial, or combination. And you have to differentiate it clinically as well as on the slide, because they will not have any feature of any hemangiomas or a hemangioendothelioma. Just to mention that this entity also exists. Then the another entity is a hemangioendothelioma. It is a group of vascular neoplasms that may be considered benign as well as malignant. And as I have told earlier, like some are locally aggressive, some are rarely metastasizing. For the first entity, intermediate vascular tumors, capillary form hemangioendothelioma, locally aggressive. It is seen in children and teenagers, associated with Kasper-Merit syndrome, microscopically lobular architecture, highly cellular, and the features overlap with hemangioma, but it is a locally aggressive lesion. So tufted angioma or a Kaposi-form hemangioendothelioma. This is a lesion from a knee in a 5-month-old girl. It shows solid growth composed of nests of ovoid cells forming slit-like lumina. Perineural invasion you can see and appreciate here. And this is again a lesion, tightly packed lobules of capillaries involving the subcutis. Then the second entity in the hemangioendothelioma group is a composite hemangioendothelioma, presenting as a bluish-purple multinodular mass. And this is a composite hemangioendothelioma. Why is it called composite? I will discuss this. Because it has various patterns. It can have a pattern of a Kaposi form or a classic hemangioendothelioma, or it can have like neuroendocrine differentiation or a retiform hemangioendothelioma. You can have nest of epithelioid cells. So it can have variable patterns. And this shows, these are having a neuroendocrine pattern but showing immunoreactivity for CD31 as well as for synaptophysin. So you see that there is an overlap in the features. That's why it is called as composite hemangioendothelioma. And this is a retiform hemangioendothelioma. The infiltrative growth of well-formed elongated vessels reminiscent of retitestes pattern, branching vessels within a sclerotic stroma with associated lymphocytic infiltrate, Dabska-like intravascular papillary structures are present. Another tumor, Dabska's tumor, I will just discuss that also. This is a retiform hemangioendothelioma, which is rarely metastasizing. Skin of distal extremities, young adults, grossly reddish purple, slowly growing plaque centered in reticular dermis. Microscopically elongated arborizing narrow vessels that resemble retitestes. Endothelial cells are monomorphic with low mitotic rate, hyperchromatic nuclei, and hobnail morphology. This is Dabsker's tumor, as I was mentioning, papillary intralymphatic angioendothelium. Seen in infants and children, in skin, slowly growing plaque or nodule, thin walled vascular spaces that contain intraluminal papillary tufts of endothelial cells, in hobnail morphology. It is a rare vascular tumor. This Dabsker's tumor, Pila papillary intralymphatic angioendothelioma, the rare vascular tumor described by Dabsker in 1969, locally invasive neoplasm with low malignant potential, occurring in infants and children, characteristic cells with a hobnail appearance. There are cavernous lymphatic spaces with prominent endothelial papillae and clusters of lymphocytes. And this is an epithelioid hemangioendothelioma with spindle sarcomatous features and increased nuclear pleomorphism. So epithelioid hemangioendothelioma, as I said, that it will be included in the malignant category. These two lesions, epithelioid hemangioendothelioma and the angiosarcoma, they are supposed to be the malignant lesions. And another entity is the pseudomyogenic hemangioendothelioma. It is a rarely metastasizing vascular tumor. Histology meaning a myoid tumor or a epithelioid sarcoma. Also called as epithelioid sarcoma-like hemangioendothelioma or fibroma-like variant of epithelioid sarcoma. Mostly occurs in lower extremities. It is locally aggressive but rarely metastasizing vascular tumor, occurring most commonly in young adults less than 40 years old. Histology, fascicles or sheets of plump spindle to epithelioid cells with bright eosinophilic cytoplasm, infiltrate surrounding the soft tissues, sheets or short fascicles with prominent inflammatory, usually neutrophilic infiltrate, in a myxoid background. Characteristic immunohistochemistry with keratin, ERG, Fly1, CD31, FOSB, CAMTA1 and INI is retained. Molecular, this T719, SERPINE1, FOSB. This is the myogenic hemangioendothelioma. This is diffuse staining with keratin AE1, AE3 and strong nuclear staining with ERG. This is again a composite hemangioendothelioma which can have a mixture of patterns, as I've said earlier, with retiform, epithelioid, spindle cell, angiosarcoma or a lymphangioma or an AV malformation like its area. So the markers remains the same, like CD31, CD34, ERG, Fly1, and it can have variable age. Kaposi form hemangioendothelioma, as I have discussed earlier, but again to recapitulate, like this is a locally aggressive tumor, which is a spindle-celled vascular tumor. But I have described here deliberately because you have to differentiate it from Kaposi sarcoma. So just a visual impression that Kaposi form hemangioendothelioma should not be confused with the Kaposi sarcoma. And then this giant cell angioblastoma, the distinctive vascular tumor with aggressive local behavior, and it has been called as giant cell angioblastoma. And this is again an example of a retiform hemangioendothelioma with prominent hobnail. So now we come to the intermediate category of a Kaposi sarcoma. It's a tumor caused by human herpes virus 8, also known as Kaposi sarcoma associated herpes virus. Although it is now established to be caused by a viral infection, there's lack of awareness among persons at risk for Kaposi sarcoma herpes virus or HSV-8 infection. This is the morphology. Basically, there are various T stages, and the typical sign is a promontory sign, which you have to remember. The vascular channels infiltrate between collagen bundles and surround existing blood vessels. This is promontory sign. The endothelial cells are plump or inconspicuous with no significant cytological atypia. The tumor cells, intracytoplasmic, pars-positive hyaline globules are stable. So the early lesions, they present as ecchymotic macules or patches. Later lesions, bluish purple papules, nodules, plaques or tumors. It's a borderline malignancy. It's slowly progressive but may involve the internal organs. So microscopically, early lesions show dermal proliferation of irregular slit-like vascular channels with extravasative erythrocytes, hemosiderin and plasma. So again, see, this is the lesion etiology. As I said, HHV-8, skin is the predominant site, but it can affect lymph nodes, visceral organs or the mucosa. It can present as a patch stage, plaque stage or a tumor stage with nodule formation. All four clinical types, like the classic or sporadic, which can occur in elderly men, then endemic, which is African, iatrogenic, and AIDS-associated. So this is the microscopic patterns which can occur at various stages, like the PAC stage, dilated vascular channels dissecting through dermal collagen, promontory sign. Then this plaque stage, there's infiltrative proliferation of spindled endothelial cells. Then nodular stage, discrete nodules composed of intersecting fascicles of uniform spindle cells. All stages you can have mitosis. Nuclear pleomorphism is usually minimal. And you can have immunohistochemistry with HHV-8 positive. Epitheloid hemangioendothelioma, it is the entity which is a malignant entity, malignant endothelial neoplasm. It involves soft tissue, bone, lung, skin and liver. Two subtypes defined by WWTR1, CAMTA1 or YAP1, TAP3 rearrangement, former expressing CAMTA1 and later TAP3. The locally aggressive tumor with metastatic potential. So there is increased mitotic rate, there is increased nuclear pleomorphism, more spindling, necrosis can be seen. So it is the other spectrum which is of going towards malignancy. The tumor cells express CD31, 34, Ulex Europeus and factor 13 related antigens. And as I have said, two types, WWTR1 CAMTA1 subtype and YAP-TAP3 subtype, and morphologically they differ. Like the earlier one, WWTR1 CAMTA1 subtype, cord strains of small nests with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm, and tumor cells may have vesicular round to oval indented nuclei, and the other one, that YAP-TAP3 subtype, a solid nest or pseudo-alveolar arrangement of epitheloid. There is minimal mitotic activity or necrosis. Now the malignant spectrum at the other end is the angiosarcoma. Malignant neoplasm. There is morphologic or immunophenotypic evidence of endothelial differentiation. Essential features: irregularly shaped anastomosing vascular channels or sheet-like growth, highly infiltrative architecture, poor demarcation, there's multi-layering of endothelial cells, nuclear atypia, increased mitosis, necrosis, and they are positive for vascular markers, and immunostains are CD31, 34, ERG, VEGF, factor 8. So, you see here, the pathogenesis is quite complex here. the various genes which are upregulated, TIE1, KRT, KFLT, KDR mutations, c-MYC amplification. So these are the molecular alterations which are occurring in angiosarcomas. They are divided into several groups like cutaneous angiosarcoma, angiosarcoma of depth, radiation-induced angiosarcoma, angiosarcoma of deep soft tissue. They are poorly circumscribed hemorrhagic masses, microscopically atypical endothelial cells with mitotic figures, infiltrative growth patterns. This is polydifferentiated angiosarcoma. This is sheets of epithelioid and spindle cells, and there is nuclear reactivity for ERG. So microscopically features, they can be of varied morphology, and they are an infiltrative lesion. It involves the subcutaneous tissues. The post-radiation lesions are usually very high grade. Again, see, there are anastomosing vascular channels, and they are lined by highly atypical endothelial cells. Then this variant epithelioid angiosarcoma, which is seen in deep soft tissue, this is a malignant epithelioid cell with abundant eosinophilic or amphiphilic cytoplasm, large vesicular nuclei, and prominent nucleoli. The positive stains, as you see, the vascular markers like PIN31, FLY1, they are positive. In addition, you will get positivity for the epithelioid like keratin A1, A3 also will be positive in this. So as I said, the molecular alterations, MYC and many others, and differential diagnosis could be the atypical vascular lesions and hemangiomas or a florid vascular proliferation. Then just to mention that, like some lymph vessels, they can be confused sometimes, like the lymphangiomas, like hemangiomas and lymphangiomas. So you must know the morphology, like the cystic hygromas and how the lymphangiomas look. They are the malformations of the lymphatic system. And they can also be like capillary and cavernous type. And this is a other spectrum to lymphangiosarcoma. And then this is a perivascular glomus tumor. Glomus cells, very characteristic. And they are negative for the vascular markers. And they are positive for smooth muscle marker, that is SME. So it can present in various forms. Classically located in subungual region, it can be also found in the skin, soft tissue, nerves, stomach, nasal cavity, and trachea. This is the characteristic glomus cell. Glomus tumor is also known as solitary glomus tumor, solid glomus tumor, or glomantioma. And this is again a vascular type of lesion. This is a vascular angiomatosis. Is associated with bacteria of the Bartonella genus with proliferation of blood vessels, which can form tumor-like masses in the skin and other organs. So with that, I complete the spectrum from benign, starting from the hemangioma, to the intermediate group, like the locally aggressive and the malignant. Any questions? My references are the WHO mainly, and Fletcher, and obviously Eckermann and Sternberg. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Very crisp and straight and clear. And I think that is exactly what is required. The blood vessel tumors nowadays are more less morphology less and more of immunohistochemistry, because the way they overlap,
yes.
And so the immunohistochemical markers as well as the molecular markers have become more and more important in diagnosing various types of vascular neoplasms. Let me just check if there are any questions. No, there are no questions on the YouTube, neither here. Right. You were saying something, ma'am. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. First, the morphology is very important. And then you have to, like, refer to IHC. because the spectrum is quite wide, because what you can like from the malformations to the hemangiomas and then the intermediate grade and to angiosarcomas, so the overlapping features are quite immense. So basically, site and age and all those things will matter, and you have to take the clinical spectrum also, you have to correlate and then...
Correct. Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am. So what is the next lecture on?
Yeah, I will just inform you.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Take care. Bye-bye. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.